The name of this video is Electric Charge. In a previous video, I told you that the source of the electric field, E, is charge. Charge is the source of the electric field E. So it's very important to understand, to grasp the concept of charge. In order to do so, the first step is to make an operative definition of charge. Where DEF, in this case, is the abbreviation which I will use hereafter for definition. So what is the operative definition of charge? It's an experimental, empirical definition. So suppose that we have two objects. Object A, here, and object B, here, into different positions in space. We want to understand if the charge of these two objects, which suppose they've been charged by rubbing beforehand, are the same or not. How do we do that? We need to use a test object, let's call it object C, located somewhere else in space. The next step is to be able to measure by means of some apparatus, which I will not describe here. Suppose that we have such an apparatus in our hands. We need to be able to measure the force due to either object A or object B on C. So suppose we can do that. Let's sketch in red those forces. So I measure the force due to A on object C. So this I call it the force F, which is a vector, on C due to A. This is the nomenclature we're going to use, on C due to A, FCA. Similarly, let's try to measure the force due to B on C. In general, these two forces can be different. So this is on C due to B, FCB. These are the two vectors which we are able to measure. By definition, that is operative definition, the objects A and B are charged with exactly the same charge, so Q, the charge on object A, in particular, the absolute value of the charge on object A, is exactly equal to the absolute value of the charged of the charge on object B if and only if the norm, that is the absolute value of the force FCA on the test object C due to A, is exactly the same as the norm of the force FCB. This is our operative definition of charge. Quiz. What happens to the sign of these charges? I leave this as a question mark, and I ask you to discuss in Piazza about this with your fellow students. All right. So this is our operative definition of charge. Unfortunately, there is a major experimental issue with this definition. So let's see what is the major experimental issue that we have with this operative definition. The issue is that, for example, suppose that I used as object here amber. We know the amber, when rubbed, gets charged with a positive or negative charge. Well, amber is electron is negative, so with a negative charge. So suppose, for example, that I wrapped more this region of this object A. So there is a lot of negative charge here in this region, but very little in this region. On the contrary, suppose they wrap mostly this region of object B. So there is a lot of negative charge here, but none there. Clearly, the shape, as well as the location, the position of this object in space, and so the distance between these objects, makes a big difference in this experiment, okay? So, in other words, shape, size, and distance between these objects make a big difference in the outcome of the experiment, which is what we are using to define charge. So the three items are shape, and so the way I charge somehow these objects, size, and distance. Let's talk about distance a little bit more in detail. So let us define a concept which we will touch again later on in this course, or perhaps in more in 342, but you already know more or less this concept for masses, so for the gravitational field, and it's the concept of center of charge, which is very similar to that of center of mass. So let's say that object A is characterized by a certain center of mass right there, whereas the center of charge, again, they're very similar, whereas the center of charge for B is somewhere in this dot. Okay, so let us define the origin, a certain origin of all vectors somewhere in space here. It could also be within this object, but for simplicity, let's choose this O origin outside the objects A and B. And so with respect to this origin, this distance OA tells us something about the location, the position of object A in space. This is called the three-dimensional Euclidean space. Similarly here, this vector RB, RB tells us where is the location of object B with respect to this origin O. And similarly, we can also define the position of object C. There will be a vector RC, which I'm not going to sketch here, associated with object C. In addition to that, object A is characterized by a volume VA, object B by a volume VB, and object C by a volume VC. So these are the volumes, and of course, a volume has unit meter cube, okay? Whereas these distances have units meter. All right, so how can we factor out of this experiment these three issues of shape, size, and distance? How do we do that? Well, one way to do that is to take, so let's assume for simplicity that the three volumes, VA, VB and VC are approximately equal to each other. They don't have to be, but now for simplicity here, let me assume that they are. And let's call these three approximately equal volumes, just V, which has units of meter cube. Similarly, the norms of the vector distances, RA and RB, let's say that they are approximately also the same, similar to RC. Okay, just for simplicity, they absolutely don't have to be. So let's call this norm just R, which is unit meter. So this is units in SI meter cube. This is in SI is unit meter. One condition which allows us to factor out these issues from the experiment is to hypothesize or to make this, to build the experiment. Actually, it's not to hypothesize, it's to build the experiment in such a way that the cubic root of V. Why cubic? Because it's meter cube, so I obtain meter as a unit now. This I want it to be much smaller than R, the distances, the interdistances between these objects. So this is the key condition I want to use in order to build a good experiment, and so to have a good operative definition of charge. The cube root of V much smaller than R. This definition is exactly equivalent to say that we are concentrating the charge of object A in its center of charge. This one, let me call it center of charge. And similarly here, I will concentrate the charge of B in its center of charge. And similarly for C, I will concentrate the charge of C, which is my test object, in its center of charge. So in this case, this implies that I can forget about, they are so far away that I cannot see, unless I have a telescope, I cannot see the shape of this object. So if I'm sitting on C, and this A is very far away, much further than its own shape and size, I cannot really resolve its contour, its shape. And so I can say that it's more or less like a point in space. And so this is the operative definition of point like charge, which we will use extensively throughout this course, entry 42 as well. So it's critical to understand point like charge. So this is the definition of point like charge. And let me circle this in yellow because it's really important. Okay. One last point before moving to the next item for charge, which is worth discussing here, is the independence from the test object C. And in fact, C is called the test object. What does it mean? It means that, so this is the key word, independence. So what this means, it means that even if I change C, as long as I'm within this definition, this operative definition of point-like charge, even if I use a different object with a different material, let's say a C prime, which can be a different material, and yet if I measure the same norm for these two forces, I can still tell that the charge, at least in absolute value, on these two objects, A and B, is the same. So this is independence from the test object, as long as this point-like charge condition is fulfilled in the experiment. All right, the last item we need to discuss to complete our definition of electric charge is that of unit charge. First step to define properly unit charge. We want to define, in fact, we want to take an object, let's call it U for unit, and use this object as our standard for charge. So we want to define a standard charge. Which again, I will call a U, which stands for unit. Okay, so this is our standard unit charge U. For example, if you go to Paris to the Museum of Standards, you can find a block of, I don't remember the metal, probably gold, let's say, that represents the standard for mass, let's say 1 kilogram. Similarly, you can, in the beginning, when people started to work on electric phenomena, you can take a very well-defined piece of amber, let's say. Typically, let's use something circular as a nice hard sphere because it's a simple structure. So we take a hard sphere made from amber. Again, it could be glass. It could be whatever you want. In fact, let me say, do you think amber is the best choice? Probably not. Let's go for glass. And you will tell me why glass would be a better choice. So I will let you discuss B for Piazza, why glass, in your opinion, would be a better choice than amber as a standard. So I take this, I polish it nicely, I make it very nice, and then I start to rub it in a very systematic fashion. So I do a systematic rubbing action to make it, in other words, altogether a reproducible experiment. Okay, this is a very, very rough method to define a standard. If you go to NIST, which is the Institute for Standards, obviously, at least in the US, obviously, they make a much more refined definition of a standard, okay? This is something very rough that perhaps people were doing a couple of hundred years ago. And now you can use many different, many more refined methods to define your standard chart. But this, bottom line, is somehow the idea behind all these more advanced methods to define a standard chart, nevertheless. So we define our standard chart U. And I will leave some space down here because we need to add some extra features to this standard charge eventually. In the second step, we need to make an experiment which is similar to our operative definition of charge as we've seen before. So, first of all, we take an object A, which is now on a point-like object, so a point-like charge. Let's call it A, somewhere in space, and a distance, let's call this distance in absolute value R, from a test object, and the test object, the test charge, we call it C. And suppose that, again, we have an apparatus that allows us to measure the force due to A on C. And let's say that this is this force. The force vector due to A on C, which has a certain amplitude or magnitude, if you want, which is the length of this vector. So this we measured. So that's our second step. In the third step of this experiment, what we want to do, we want to replace this object A with a set of unit charges, okay? And so, of course, I'm already hypothesizing something which I will not tell you yet, I will tell you in a minute. So what we do, instead of taking a single object A, we start to take in the same region of space, of course, in this region of space, we take one unit charge, okay? And again, suppose that this unit charge, everything is point-like, it's at the same distance, small r, from my test object C. Okay, and so then we start to measure with the same apparatus the force due to this unit charge, which let's say is this little amount on C. We measure it. Is it the same as the force due to A on C? Let's say it's not, it's smaller. Okay, so we add another unit charge there. And we measure a tiny bit more of a force. Is it the same as the one due to A? No. So we have one more, until eventually we obtain exactly the same force as before. So we measure the same vector FAC, or at least the same magnitude, okay? So in this case, we replaced A with a number of U's. Let's say N times U's is equal to A. To be more precise, and really, what I'm trying to do here is to say that the charge on A, okay, is actually equal to N times, let's say capital N times, the charge Q of one unit charge U, which I defined before. So there is a unit charge QU associated with this standard object U. Okay, so that's what we do. Okay. In this way, we managed to say, we can tell how many unit charges I need to put together in order to obtain the same result as the charge A. So I'm comparing my charge A with a set of unit charges. And that's the way we do things in physics. Okay, as it turns out, in SI, the SI unit of charge is the Coulomb. In fact, either you write it Coulomb with lowercase c, or if you want, you write Coulomb with capital C. So this is the Coulomb. As it turns out, one Coulomb is actually huge. So here we need to think, we need to be smart in order to make this kind of replacement, to make it to work. For example, let me give you an example here, which I think is in order. Suppose that our object A is characterized by a charge of, let's say, one point five microcoulombs, for example. And note that I'm already complicating things because I'm using something fractional, okay? Which I didn't really explain yet here. And this has to do with the accuracy of the of your standard charge of choice. Okay, suppose they're 1.5 microcoulombs, okay? So if I were to choose, a standard charge QU of 1 microcoulomb, do you think this is a good choice? Well, not really, because in the best case scenario, I can say that QA, after I replace QA with 1 of these QUs, I'm already close to the value of QA, but not quite, still halfway. And if I put 2, I'm still also halfway. So obviously I can only say that it's between 1 and 2 microcoulombs, okay? In a range between 1 and 2 microcoulombs. Not very good, not very accurate. So instead of using such a rough big unit charge for this specific type of charge QA, which I've chosen here, I could choose 1 nanocoulomb. Okay, well, in this case, I can be very precise, because if I put together 1,500 of these nanocoulombs, I obtain exactly the charge QA. And so this is much more accurate, okay? Much more accurate. It would be even more accurate if I were to choose 1 picocoulomb or something smaller, okay? So clearly, the last item which I was supposed to write down here for our definition of standard charge is that this standard charge QU has to be small enough compared to QA to be enough accurate. So this is the key which we were supposed still to write down there. And this example, I hope, gives you a clear idea. And also, by means of this approach, we can clearly understand that fractional charges also are captured in this definition. Of course, if here I had 1 coulomb, 1 nanocoulomb perhaps is overkill, and it's okay to choose 1 microcoulomb. Okay. One last note, which I think is important to make here, is that, as it turns out, this fact of fractional charges is actually very important in physics, because as it turns out, you cannot go lower than a fundamental minimum limit in terms of charge. The smallest charge UQU that you are allowed to choose by physics is the absolute value of the charge of an electron, which is approximately 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulomb. So it's very small, but you cannot go smaller than that. And this is because charge is quantized. As a matter of fact, you could go smaller by defining quarks, but it's definitely something which we're not going to do in this course. So for us, the smallest charge that we can have is the charge of an electron, okay? So that's the best accuracy, the best granularity you can get to replace an object A with something else, with the charge of many, many, many electrons.